We're back in the saddle again. We're back. Welcome to Neighbor Notes, a sibling's guide to simple syncopation. My name is Sam.
I am Jake. And you know, folks, you might have realized we've been a little absent.
We took a little break because life happened. I just graduated college and I just did a big move across state lines. It was really intensive, and I've been very busy. I'm still very busy.
And we got, like, nothing really set up, so we've had no time.
Yeah,
like,
we've had absolutely no time to do this. But I have now quit my second job, and like the Chilean miners, we have reemerged to once again entertain you with our podcast, Nonsense and Tomfoolery.
Entertainment is used very liberally in this case.
I guess if this is how you get your kicks, I'm not going to stop you. This isn't the worst thing you could be doing. Like, this is, it's not drugs.
It's not drugs.
That's our motto here on this podcast. It's not drugs.
That's what my mom told me.
Neighbor Notes, it's not drugs.
I'll update that shortly.
And that's what you need to tell your parents.
Don't worry, I'm listening to a podcast and not doing drugs.
It's not drugs. That's what they always say.
So, Sam, what do you got in store for us today?
Okay, so I have not told Jake anything about what we're doing today because I kind of just pulled it out of my butt.
Like all days.
Yeah, like most days. With most things that I do in my life, I pulled it out of my butt. But I actually have an announcement. I know we just got back. Like, we just got back from in the saddle again.
Yes, we are back. We are in the saddle for one more time.
Yeah, but it's over now.
One night only.
We're done.
All right.
The podcast is over, and this is going to be the final cadence of the podcast.
You will be missed.
Yeah, goodbye, because we're talking about cadences today.
Okay.
I getcha. I was just kidding. It's not actually the end of the podcast.
Man.
I know, you're sweating. Yeah. Oh, we haven't even mentioned, Jake, like, this is the same room energy.
Yeah, we are currently, this is how it's going to go for a while now.
We're actually recording in the same room on the same microphone.
Yeah, so I will go ahead and warn you, it might not sound amazing.
Yeah, we didn't have a lot of options right now. All of my recording stuff is packed up in a storage unit. And so we're making the best of a bad situation.
One room, one microphone, one podcast, we're going to do this right.
Simultaneous being, four arms, four legs.
Two brains.
Are you sure about that one? Because I think, I was going to say, maybe together.
A quarter of a brain.
We make maybe half a brain together.
I mean, you graduated college.
Yeah, I don't know how.
Okay, fair enough.
I don't know. They shouldn't have given me that piece of paper that says I'm good at music.
It's like there was a ditto in your head that just kind of like mimicked a brain a while. And then as soon as you got the paper,
it turned back into the pink mush. it's the one from the Detective Pikachu movie that really is just a big pile of bubblegum. That's all that's up there is a big pile of bubblegum. That's why I rely on the internet to do this research, because I don't remember any of this stuff from school.
And research you did.
Yeah, I did. I hacked your computer and I did some research. Fun fact about my brother, he hasn't changed his computer password since middle school.
That's really great for you to put out onto the...
Well, they don't know your middle school password. I do, and I'm not going to say it out loud.
I mean, yes, but that just looks bad for me.
Listen, unless somebody wants to come to your house and type in a password on that computer that I'm looking at, and log into it, this information can't harm you.
I request that you do not do that.
Yeah, please don't come break into this house. People might have something to say about that.
So, Neighbor Notes.
So, cadences. Jake, do you know what a cadence is?
I mean, when you say cadence, I think of drum cadence, I think of drum rhythm, I think of drum groove, but I do know that a cadence is technically... I say technically, but I don't entirely.
Just tell me what you think, and I'll tell you if you're right or wrong.
The ending passage of a piece of music.
That is pretty much correct.
Yes.
And the other thing you said isn't wrong either, and I'll talk about that in a second. So what is a cadence? It's a harmony that gives a sense of resolution. So it's an ending. It's finality. It's a pause. It essentially is a series of chords or notes, we'll get into that later, that marks the end of something.
Okay.
So most music that you're going to listen to will end with a cadence, and I'll actually explain why you don't often hear it very strongly in pop music, and that's something I'll talk about later. Ooh. But most of the time, when you listen to good classical music, there's lots of different chords that they use throughout the music. There's there's tons and tons. I would say like near infinite, but there's definitely a finite number of chords that exist when you're going like,
I just make some new ones. Let's get infinite going.
Yeah. You can just make up some new ones if you want, though. I'm pretty sure they went ahead and named them all.
Be warned though, if you make a new one, you will be heated as a visionary.
Oh yeah. You're going to be the next Bach.
So be careful. It's a slippery slope.
Be really careful about making new chords. So the word cadence comes from the Latin root cadere, C-A-D-E-R-E, which means to fall. So like falling towards the end of a phrase, you're falling out, you know. The word cadence has other meanings. It doesn't just mean the end of a musical phrase. People use cadence to describe the inflections of someone's voice. So like there's their cadence when they speak. Or like you said, a drum pattern can be referred to as a cadence because it also has connotations of rhythm. Okay. When you think of cadence, you also think of rhythm.
Yeah, when I first heard of like the real practical term for cadence was more or less just like something near like bringing up the resolution of a song.
Yeah.
I was so confused in high school because drum cadences, I was like, that wasn't the end. That was repeating for like hours.
Yeah. Which still happens today. Well, again, the pop music, we'll talk about that later.
Oh, wonderful.
But, so yeah, the most common uses for cadence are ending phrases, which means like ending a musical phrase, you move on to the next one. Or, and just ending whole pieces, often whole musical pieces, well, pretty much always, whole musical pieces will end on some sort of cadence. And even if it's not like a classic one, there are lots of different kinds of cadences. And then also you'd use a cadence, for like modulating.
Okay.
So there's, like I said, there's lots of different types of cadences. The most common, the ones that you see the most often and that are the most resolving, I guess that's not a good word, but, those are authentic cadences.
Authentic.
Yeah.
The real deal.
Those are the
original.
Those are them OG cadences.
Them OG. Number one. A1.
Real gamer.
One. Real gamers.
Real hip gamer cadences. And authentic cadences go from a 5 chord to a 1 chord. And what I mean by that, if you don't quite know what that means, is a 5 chord is a chord where the bottom note of that chord is the 5th note of the scale. Whatever scale you're in, whatever key you're in. If you put the 5th note as the tonic, or the root of your chord, tonic is a different thing. If you put that as the root of your chord, why are you playing with the audio, Jake?
Because
you're deeply offending me and my explanation of cadences.
Something. I mean, you can keep going. That was definitely the idea.
I got distracted. You're distracting me with your clicking. Anyway, so a 5 chord. The root of the chord is the 5th note of the scale. And then a 1 chord, the 1st note of the scale. That's your tonic. That would be the root of that chord. So if you go from 5 to 1, that is considered an authentic cadence. Now, there's different types of authentic cadences.
Wow.
We're going to get this a lot, where there's like, he figured out what he was trying to play with.
Yes,
on his computer,
I did it.
Which he rudely interrupted me with earlier.
I did, and I'm actually keeping that in because
I can't stand you at all. So there's different types of authentic cadences. You're going to see this a lot where it's like there's a base category of something and then a subcategory of it. So the two main types of authentic cadences are perfect and imperfect. So a perfect authentic cadence, it's often referred to just as a PAC.
Okay.
That means that both of the chords, the 5 chord and the 1 chord, are in root position. And that means when you're thinking about 4 voices, I'm sorry, we just had a moment because one of the light bulbs in here burned out and we got real spooked.
Oh, that's so funny.
Yeah. You need to replace that light bulb.
Yeah, that's true. This is a great recording, by the way.
Okay, so on a side note, it's really hot in here because we can't have the air conditioner running while we're recording this because it's very loud and I'm dying.
Recording 101, baby.
I'm dying. Let me just take a drink here. That was refreshing. Feeling real good. Throat's all wet. So, a perfect authentic cadence, the chords are in root position. And what that means is the root note of the chord, which is, you know, in a five chord, it's the fifth note. It's also called the dominant, mm-hmm. the fifth note of a scale.
Hey, I learned that in theory this semester.
Whoa! Well, in four-part harmony, when you've got, like, a scale or a chord with four notes, that would mean that the root note, the five, would be in the lowest voice. And so it's holding down the bass there. It's on the bottom. And then the same with the one chord. The one note needs to be the root. That needs to be the bottom of the chord.
Right on.
The other qualification for it to be a perfect authentic cadence is that the tonic, which is the first note of the scale, has to be in the highest voice at the end in that one chord.
Oh.
So the top voice, the soprano, whoever's doing the high part, usually, you know, the melody in a song, has to end on the root note, the tonic note. And it's considered the strongest cadence. It's considered, like, the most final. It's usually what you're going to find at the end of a song. A big straight 5-1. Everything in root position. It all resolves. Everybody's happy.
And, yeah, resolving to that tonic, because music likes to do that.
Yeah, you always got to go back to where you started.
That makes sense. Completely.
It helps you feel finished. It helps you feel like you're done with it. Because if you just leave off on a 5 chord, you feel like you're not done. Which, that's another thing that we'll talk about in a minute. An imperfect authentic cadence, or an IAC, which it means...
Could be better. Could be, you know, perfect. But, you know, who's asking?
But now, there's different kinds of imperfect authentic cadences.
Still not perfect.
The three main ones, root position IACs, are... Okay, the light turned back on. The bulb turned back on. We can't keep doing this. We can't keep recording in this room. It's a travesty. Oh, all right. Back in the zone. The root position IAC, an imperfect authentic cadence, is almost the same as a perfect authentic cadence, but that tonic in the high voice isn't there. So everything's in root position, it's standard chords, it's just that the melody voice, the top voice, is singing a different note. So it's not perfect. You can still use it to end a piece, you can still use it to end a phrase, it's just not as punch-in-the-face final, we're done,
it's as a perfect. It's everyone's second choice.
Yeah, it's your second choice if you can't quite make that soprano hit that note. You're like, we can drop it down, it's fine, you can hit the fifth.
It's like Karen can't
Karen, I know you can't quite hit a high D yet. We're working on it, but we're just going to go ahead and drop it down to an A. Mm-hmm. And you're fine. You'll be able to hit it, except it's not perfect and you're a failure.
Poor Karen.
She lost her scholarship because of that. The other types of imperfect authentic cadences, there's an inverted IAC, which means that at least one of the chords is inverted.
CAI.
What? Oh, I hate you.
You were genuinely confused.
It took
confused.
Me a second. You should... CIA would be a dyslexic authentic cadence. That was bad. That was terrible.
That was awful. Actually, I would argue the worst.
Well, if you don't quite know what an inversion is, it's essentially when I said, you know, the root of the chord, that's the note that's on the bottom... it's just, that note is a different note in the chord. It's not the fifth note in the scale for a 5 chord. It's like the seventh one or the second one. It's they flipped the chord around and made a different note on the bottom. Yeah. And that changes a lot. You might think, oh, it's all the same notes. What's the difference? There's a big difference.
Yeah.
And when you hear it, you can really tell, oh, that doesn't sound as final. That doesn't sound as good. So that's how you get an inverted IAC. The last one is a leading tone. Imperfect authentic cadence. And this one's weird because it doesn't go from a 5 chord to a 1 chord. It actually goes from a 7 chord, a diminished 7 chord. So that's going to be like the 7th note of the scale. And it just goes from that to 1.
Hmm.
Instead, which still gives you a sense of resolution because it's still like, you know, the dissonance to the... And if you look at a diminished 7th chord, it has a lot of the same notes that a 5 chord does. It's just a different note on the bottom. They're in different orders. So it still sounds like an ending, but it's not quite as strong. Now, I mentioned if you leave something on a 5 and don't resolve it to 1, it just, like, it makes you feel bad.
Yeah.
You want it to resolve, and it's just awful. That's called a half cadence. Oh, and it's half, those it's half are the evil because ones. It does, yeah, it doesn't finish. And a lot of times they'll use that to end phrases inside of a song. And they'll, like, resolve it in the next passage. They'll use it to, like, bridge a phrase to another phrase.
Sort of, like, keeps you on your toes.
Yeah. So it's like if you have an 8-bar phrase, an 8-measure phrase, and you end that 8th measure on the 5, and that's definitely the end of the phrase, and then it restarts again on the 1, that'd be a half cadence.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so it's all, that one's not so much about what chords you're using or what position they're, the notes are in, it's about where you use it. So, and again, you wouldn't end a whole song on a half cadence, because just ending on a 5 would be mean to the people listening. Just end it on that nice 5 but chord.
Boy, would it be funny.
Yeah. just cut your song off after the 5 chord, and everybody's like, what?
And then everybody stands up, bows, that's, and you get the one person with, like, the very slow clap. And everybody else is like, why are you clapping?
No, then they just start throwing things at you.
True.
And you have to run. That's when
then it becomes a game of dodgeball.
Oh, then it becomes a game of dodge whatever they have in their hand. Dodge programs.
You better hope it's not nice.
Dodge those little opera glasses. those little binoculars they use at the opera.
You better hope they don't have
those. They have those still, right? Do people still do those?
I think so.
So you're going to get opera binoculars thrown at you.
So that's scary. So you got to be ready for that if you're going
to
do this.
Yeah, you got to be ready. Those probably won't feel good to hit you in your body. Some of the other most common types of cadences that I learned about in school and that you hear in things. There's a plagal cadence, which you don't hear so much nowadays, but if you go back to, like, you know, classic church, like, liturgical writing, you'll see plagal cadences, because it's also called the amen cadence, because a lot of times in church music, when they sing the amen at the end of a song, it's plagal cadence. And what that means is it's a 4-1 instead of a 5-1. So it's the 4th note of the chord that's called the subdominant. And it's just like, it doesn't feel as done when you go from a 4-1 as it does when you go from a 5-1. And that's there's not really a better way to put it. It's about how it makes you feel. And there's no, like, I don't have a good, like, scientific, like, big words explanation for that. It's just like how you feel when you listen to it. Feels like it's done. Or I guess it feels like it's done. Or we said amen, so it's done, right? this is the one where we said amen, so we're done. I can go home, right? This was me when I was a child going to church. We're done, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
We said the amens. We're done.
We can leave.
We can leave and go play video game.
Oh, video no, James. Those dastardly video James.
Video James. We can go play his games. The last kind of cadence, my favorite kind of cadence, is a deceptive cadence. Deceptive cadences are very fun, because exactly as the name implies, they do trick you.
I love it.
Because usually it's the same kind of buildup that you would get to a normal cadence. You go to that big 5 chord, and then instead of resolving down to 1, it resolves to 6. The 5 just goes up a step instead of dropping down to the 1. And it's so fun, because you expect it. You're like, here comes that resolution. Okay, never mind. And then it just doesn't. And
they're the sneaky ones.
It's super, super sneaky. It leaves you hanging, like little Timmy did with that crisp high five on the playground.
Oh, shame.
In the 5th grade.
Can't avoid it.
I don't know where I pulled that from. I don't know. That came out of nowhere.
I don't know, but I did enjoy it. I will give you props for your improv.
Thanks.
Say very good.
Thanks.
Very good.
I really felt like Timmy was here in this moment, and I wanted to punch him in the face for leaving me hanging on that high five.
I didn't, but
that again, it wasn't you telling the story, so shut up.
All right. Okay.
Now, cadences, obviously, a cadence suggests chords, which suggests multiple notes. Like, you know, like, chords are usually at least a triad, which is 3 notes. Sometimes you add a 4th note on top. If you do that, it's a 7 chord, you know, because it uses the 7th. Yeah. So so that's typically how chords are done. But as you probably know, we didn't always have polyphonic music.
Yeah.
It took a really long time for it to be okay to play more than one note at once, because back in the day, monophonic chant was a big thing where everybody had to be singing the same note, or it was a slight to God.
I was about to say, was it a church thing?
It was a church thing. Well, we're going to do a whole episode on the Council of Trent, because, oh boy, the Council of Trent. They tried to ban polyphony in the Council of Trent, which, again, means, you know, more than one voice singing
at
the
same Trent, time. Trent was like, yo, bros, we're going to get
no,
this.
No, okay. No, that's not.
Okay.
It wasn't the guy named Trent. It was
I like that idea,
It was
though.
A place.
I love that idea,
called
though.
Called Trent.
I love that idea,
You love the idea of just...
Just this dude bro named Trent just telling everybody what they can and can't do with this music.
And back in medieval times, of course. There was a man named Trent who said, I don't like polyphony, get rid of it. No, at the Council of Trent, they attempted to ban polyphony because they claimed it obscured liturgy. They claimed with more than one person singing at once in different notes, it's hard to understand the words. So we're not getting the meaning of the scripture. We're not getting God from this. God can't understand you. So you're not doing it right.
You have to play this in a way God would understand.
Yeah, it's because if you can't understand the words, what's the point? There was an entire piece written just to prove that, hey, you can still understand the words with polyphony. And they eventually said, okay, fine. And they backed off. I am trying so hard to remember who wrote that piece. And it's just flew out of my brain.
Notes can't help
it's
you here.
It's gone. Notes can't help me. I didn't write this one down. This is, I'm improvising right now. I'm off book. Y'all, I'm off book.
10, you're going off script. It's right here.
Yeah, it's down in my notebook that I stole from you off of your desk.
No, was that my audio notebook?
I took like 3 pages of it.
Okay, fine.
Please, calm down. I'm sure. I'll go buy you a new one at Walmart for 99 cent.
Yay.
Calm down. I have a dozen in the storage unit. I'll bring you a new notebook. I couldn't find my neighbor notes book. Yeah, that's what I'm going to call it.
Yeah, that was good.
It's my very special notebook where I put all my notes for this podcast. I don't know where I put it. I think it might be in the storage unit. So I stole this piece of paper. So where I'm going with all this in relation to cadence... back in medieval times and in like it moved on into the Renaissance, as they were slowly adding in more voices, it wasn't always, you know, like 4 or 5, it wasn't always like huge sections of the band all playing different things at once. It used to be just like a couple people singing different notes. And so, cadences, quote unquote, in medieval times were defined by, or they were based on dyads, which is, you know, a triad is 3 notes played at the same time. A dyad is 2.
Wow.
So it's essentially just like an interval, 2 notes that are being sung or played at the same time.
Simple enough.
Yeah, so that was because they didn't really have more voices going at once. Chords weren't really a thing yet, so it was based on counterpoint, which, you know, is a line of melody moving on top of a bass. And it would just be those 2 notes, and that's how they define a cadence. The first ever sort of theoretical mention of cadences, it didn't use the word cadence, but the first... written mention of what we're talking about, the finality, the ending of a phrase, was written by Guido de Arezzo. And Guido de Arezzo is a very famous figure in the history of music because he did a lot for music. He did a lot for teaching music. He was like the father of music education because he did a lot of things that made music easier to teach. He was a Benedictine monk. And he would teach, obviously, all, you know, it's all in the church. He would teach music for the church. One of the biggest things he did was he actually developed what we know today as solfege.
Oh, I know about solfege.
Yeah, solfege, if you don't know, it's, you know, do, re, mi, fa, so, la, ti, do. It's the syllables that we use to dictate different notes in a scale. Guido de Arezzo was the first person to come up with this. The original syllables he used were ut, re, mi, fa, so, and la. So a lot of that carried over. Ut was later changed to do, and T was added in as later when scales were developed and leading tones became a thing. I think T was originally called C, but somebody, a woman decided, I don't like that there's 2 S's. I want each one to start with a different letter. So we're going to call it T now.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
Sounds about right.
And that left room, actually, if you sing C, that actually means, I think, a sharp so.
Yeah.
So, like, if you're singing so and it's raised a half step, you'd say C instead.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. He helped develop that. And one of the ways he helped teach this and one of the ways he revolutionized education was his hand.
His hand?
His hand.
His hand.
Guido's hand.
Guido's hand.
The hand is a very... famous image in music history. I saw it in a textbook when I was learning. And essentially it's a drawing. It's a chart of somebody's hand. And he would use the different digits of your hand as different solfege. And he would use, it's like, okay, look at this chart and then look at your hand. All the different parts of your hand are different notes. They're different chords. And you can use just your hand to learn music. And it was really cool. The best part is the hand itself, like actually looking at it. Now, Jake, if you go onto your computer, I did save you a sweet little bookmark of that hand if you just pop open Chrome.
Okay.
You see your first bookmark there on the left. You've got the hand of Guido.
Let's see. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Hey.
Now that's...
That's
the hand of Guido.
I don't like the hand of Guido.
I love it. It's amazing.
I mean, we'll link a picture in the description.
Yeah,
but
it's a really good picture of I'm gonna give you a little description. Guido de Arezzo is there. And he has two very large hands, one larger than the other. The first hand is kind of just sticking straight out of his shoulder.
Yeah, he like doesn't have an arm. It's straight up like in his shoulder.
It's just in his shoulder and it's real big. But if you look kind of along the outside circle of the hand, you can see the solfege. You can see re, mi, fa. Yeah, it's written.
Yeah.
It's written differently than we'd see it today, but you can see it written.
Yeah, I see.
And all you see all the different joints of the hand have different things written on them. Those were different things in music that he would teach you. His other hand is also too large, and it's got one really long finger that's pointing at the other hand. It's unsettling to look at, but I love it.
I love Guido. I don't like his hair.
He's a good guy. You can close out of the Guido hand now if you want to. Okay. All right. I had to show you that.
I know
you
did.
It's really important. Now, the mention of cadences I was talking about was his Micrologus, which was his treatise on music and music education and stuff like that that he wrote. He mentioned what he called an accursus, which meant two lines ending in unison. So that's a cadence. He mentioned, like, motion from music down to a unison, and that's what he would have thought of as a cadence, the ending of a passage. So that was the first sort of recorded mention of something resembling cadences. Now, in the medieval times, I don't know why I refer to them as the medieval times. Medieval times.
Yeah, I mean, medieval times.
Because it would be better to say, like, the medieval period.
There you go. Yeah, I think that would work better.
Yeah, so during the medieval period and up to the Renaissance, there were a bunch of different kinds of cadences that worked based on these dyads. There was the clausula vera, which would approach a unison or an octave, which, you know, is the same note played, like, eight steps apart. It's still the same note. It's just higher or lower.
Higher pitched or lower
pitched. So it would approach that in stepwise contrary motion. So what that means is the note before the unison, both of the notes need to be moving in different directions. So say like your note before your unison, the top note had to start higher and then the bottom note started lower. So that way they both moved inwards together, but they're moving in different directions. It's not like they're not both going up and they're not both going down. One's going down and one's going up.
Okay.
I'm making big gestures with my fingers to show Jake what I mean, but you guys can't
so
see
I get
these
it.
Gestures.
I get it a little bit better.
Essentially, one note moves up while the other one moves down. They can either be moving outwards or inwards, but they need to move in different directions. They can't... if they move together, it's called parallel motion, and that's different, and you don't want that. Contrary motion was necessary for it to be a clausula vera. Now, a plagal cadence back in these days would have been known by the lower voice either like moving up a perfect fifth or down a perfect fourth. So that's a big leap. It's not the same as it just moving one step like the clausula vera. It's a big leap, but it still leads to that... unison or that octave. My favorite medieval cadence is called a pause.
A pause.
And that's when one voice just stops.
Yay!
One voice just cuts out completely. There's a rest. And the other voice sings the tonic.
That's so
their solution to how to end a song was just let one person stop.
That's so weird. That's... doesn't sound right.
It's great. No, it's totally right. They would just put a rest.
It's totally
if they couldn't
right.
find a way to make the note move naturally to the unison or move in a way that they liked, they would just make them stop.
All right, keep singing.
All right, you stop.
All right. Greg, shut up. Let him sing.
Greg, just don't sing this bar. It just doesn't work. Just stop.
All right, now, Tim, you keep going. Oh, perfect.
Oh, there we
perfect.
Go. That's that ending we needed. That's that. We don't know what a cadence is yet, but that's that a cursus is the word that Guido de Arezzo would use. There's other different places that you'll see different cadences. Like in jazz, there's a totally different word for cadences in jazz. They're called turnarounds.
Hey.
Yeah, if you've ever heard that
term word before. Just sounds very jazzy.
Yeah, turnaround, it's because it's a chord progression that turns around to the tonic.
Huh.
So like you're going, and it just turns right back around to where you started. Yeah. And that's kind of the whole basis of all of it. But they call them turnarounds, and that's fun. There's a lot of cliches and stuff with cadences in jazz, but I'm not going to get too deep into that because that would take a while. I forgot on the jazz section. I did write "You Like Jazz."
Of course you did.
Like the funny meme like from the Bees movie. So one of my favorite you liked that?
No,
I'm You Like Jazz?
Let's move on.
Okay. One of my favorite sort of quirks of cadences came about in the classical period, and it was cadential trills. And this became a big thing for a really long time. And if anybody ever plays a classical concerto, they're going to do this.
Oh, yay.
And you hear it a lot on piano, mostly on piano, actually, because it's easier to do. It's easier to trill just like between two notes with your fingers than like trying to like a lot of times because on instruments, like especially wind instruments, there's so many buttons to press. Trilling can be weird if there's not specific keys for it. So I'm just thinking about my oboe, and it just has so many buttons. There's so many buttons. So the reason that cadential trills existed was because these composers wanted to draw out their cadences as long as possible before ending on the tonic. They wanted you to feel that sense of like hanging on the edge of your seat, and then it falls into the tonic. What would happen is that you would hear the main instrumentalist, the soloist in a concerto, would start their trill on the supertonic, which is the second note of the chord. They would trill on that note, and then it's like when you hear the da la 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 da da dum, and that's like how it would end pieces. That's how if you've ever heard the word cadenza.
Yeah.
A cadenza is an extended passage at the end of, like, a solo movement in which the soloist can, you know, freely muck about, do whatever they want, and then it resolves back into the chord, and then the rest of the orchestra joins back in.
It's
sort of orchestral coda.
I had heard, like, of those, like, I've heard those passages before. I just did not know what they were called.
Yeah, where, like, the whole orchestra cuts out, and it's just the soloist.
And the soloist just kind of, like, messing around.
They go freestyle, they go hard in the paint, and they just do the thing.
Yeah.
And it's great. I had to do cadences before. I'm not the best at it, because I get weird when it comes to improvisation. But if I have time to write something out, I can make some fancy stuff.
Yeah, I remember last semester in jazz band, we played a Steely Dan song.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Steely Dan.
I like how does this relate? I'm excited to learn.
Because that's sort of what happened at the end. It was sort of like where
there was a cadenza.
There was a cadenza
Steely
at
Dan
the end.
Song.
Yeah, because the guitar just kind of like ripped at the end, and everybody just kind of like shut up.
Yeah.
While he went for it, and then they all ended on the tonic.
Yeah, that was a Steely Dan cadenza.
That was a Steely cadenza.
A Steely cadenza. Steely cadenza.
There we go.
And we solved it.
We did it. Hey, we resolved it.
We resolved it. This is the cadence. This is the end of the episode. Just kidding. I have a little more to talk about. We have a little bit more time that we need to fit in here. This is going to be a short episode.
True.
So, yeah, these cadential trills were really popular. Mozart loved them. So did Beethoven. Mozart really loved them. Like, Mozart, like, freaking loved them. Like, I had to play the Mozart Oboe Concerto as part of my, you know, thing I had to do to graduate. And, yeah, there was a lot of them things. He does it, like, in the middle of phrases. You're supposed to, like, do these trills anytime, like, the five goes to one, and they're like marked in there, and it just, they're everywhere. Mozart just did this so much. He just really loved to hear them dang trills. Yeah. So that's a little bit of the history of the cadence and how that was used all throughout time. But there's one more thing I want to talk about because I found something really interesting in my research. And it may surprise you that what I want to talk about is the Beatles.
The Beatles. Yeah. Okay.
I know those guys. I don't know if this is like common knowledge, but I'm not a huge fan of the Beatles. Mostly just, I just like, they're a lot overhyped and everybody always says, you know, the Beatles are the most amazing thing to happen to music, but it was just a bunch of dudes doing music.
So I don't. Just a bunch of dudes.
Just a bunch of dudes. I don't put them up on a pedestal. It's like, whatever. They made good music. This is going to be controversial. I'm going to get flamed for that. My Twitter's going to get blowed up for my criticism of the Beatles.
I'm just letting you go at it because
I found a website that the entire dedication of the website was to analyzing Beatles music. They went back through like the whole catalog of the Beatles music and would analyze it and write articles about it. And they had a whole article on the Beatles' use of deceptive cadences. And I thought that was really interesting, so I want to talk about it.
Ooh, cool.
So the first thing I do have in my notes is used deceptive cadences.
Wow.
They sure did. They did use some deceptive cadences.
There they are.
Now, the thing about their use of deceptive cadences was they didn't always use it as a cadence. And so when I say cadence, I mean the end of a phrase or I mean the end of a song. A lot of times they would use the 5-6 chord progression, but they wouldn't use it as an ending. They would use it either just in the middle of a phrase, just do 5-6, or they would use it to bridge phrases. Like I was saying, they would technically be considered half cadences instead of being considered true deceptive cadences, because it would be a 5 at the end of a phrase and then a 6 to start the next phrase. So those don't count as deceptive cadences. They use the same chords, but they're not deceptive cadences. Okay. But out of the, I believe it was 211 songs in the Beatles catalog, there are 7 songs that use distinct deceptive cadences. And I have the names of all of them.
Ooh, cool.
These songs are P.S. I Love You, Do You Want to Know a Secret, Not a Second Time, When I Get Home, Oh Bloody Oh Blah Da. I've never heard that. I'll be honest, I haven't heard a lot of these things. I Will and Octopus's Garden.
Okay.
Those are the 7 songs of the Beatles that use deceptive cadences as cadences.
And once you collect them all, you become all powerful and you get to use deceptive cadences to ruin society.
Once you collect them all, you get to make one wish to the...
to the cadence gods.
What's the guy's name from Dragon Ball Z?
Oh, to Shenron.
Shenron. You get to make a wish to Shenron and that wish will be granted.
However, you know, he does have one stipulation. It has to be music related.
It does have to be music related. It's if you go for a deceptive route, good on you. So in these 7 songs, mostly the deceptive cadences were used to delay the resolution to one. So it's just meant to make you hang on for a little bit longer, and then we're done. We're at the end. For example, P.S. I Love You and Do You Want to Know a Secret, Do This. They use the deceptive cadence simply to extend that phrase by 2 bars. So typically they were both like 8-bar phrases, but then they would do the deceptive cadence on the 8th bar, which then left room for another 5 and a 1. So that it'd be a 10-bar phrase instead. So it just makes you hang on a little bit longer before you get the real resolution. The song with the most deceptive cadences was the song When I Get Home, which has 9 deceptive cadences within the song.
That's exciting. Yeah. You know?
Now, and these cadences were also mostly used just to extend the phrases. They weren't like actual endings of thoughts, passages. They were used to extend. But there was only one song where the tonic was actually replaced with the 6, and the 6 was the end. Like, it resolved 2-6, and it never goes back to 1. It just keeps going. And that was the song Not a Second Time. And that one actually did that.
Interesting.
The song that uses this the least, there's one song that only uses it once, and that's the song Oh Bloody Oh Blah Da. And the reason that this one's notable is it only uses 1, but it's, like, right in the middle of the song, and it's also after we've already heard the resolution to 1 a few times. You've already heard it go from 5-1 several times at this point, and when you hear it go to 6, it's just you're like, wait a minute, what? That's not what happened last time.
Well, hey, I think they did their job in deceiving you.
Exactly. That's the real deception. That was the most authentic use of a deceptive cadence for its original purpose.
You have
to deceive.
You have to deceive yourself before you can deceive your listeners.
Before you can deceive others. And the last two songs, I Will and Octopus's Garden, they just use the deceptive cadences at the end of the song. So like at the very end, they use it to sort of extend the ending and to keep the ending going. Now, this brings me to my last point that I wanted to make. I didn't really write notes about this, but it's something I know off the cuff about pop music.
Oh, yeah.
I had mentioned the use of cadences in pop music. You don't think about this a lot. Have you ever wondered, Jake, why songs often just fade out? They yeah. don't end on, like, a note. They'll just fade.
Yeah, that you know, you say that, and I was thinking that earlier when you mentioned pop songs have really weird ways of going about it.
Yeah. You know why? Because a lot of times in pop songs, there's a magic chord progression that is used in so many pop songs. It's called, they call it like the four chords. And what that is it is a progression from 1 to 4 to 5 to 1. And a lot of times, popular music will just repeat that chord progression over and over and over again. Nothing exciting happens. There's no modulation. There's no, like, weird chords thrown in. There's no deceptive cadences. It just goes 1-4-5-1, 4-5-1, 4-5. Oh, and it's just, like, over and over and over again. And when you hear that enough times, you know the 5-1 is a cadence. That's the end of a phrase. But when you hear it so many times, it stops feeling like the end.
Okay.
And so... if they just ended it on a 5-1, it would sound like the rest of the song. And so...
It would be really weird. It'd weird, be a really yeah. silly ending.
Yeah, it'd be a silly ending to just, like, suddenly cut it off on the thing that you've already heard 10 times before. So they just faded out.
So they say, let's forget about creativity, and let's just kind of fade. Just
start fading. And
simple solution.
Yeah. And that's why that happens, is because they just keep repeating this... Because, like I said, the perfect authentic cadence, which is that 5-1, is supposed to be, like, the most final, the finite. It is the ending. It makes you feel like you're done. And when you hear that so many times, you can't really make it feel like it's done. Usually that's reserved for, like, the ending of a long phrase or the ending of a piece in, you know, a big classical piece of music. When you just smash it over and over again, you just gotta kind of...
It just gets to the point where it's like, all right, let's keep remembering. All right, let's keep going.
All right. And then the song's over.
Yeah. So.
And then your player goes to the next one. That is how pop music uses cadences. And on that note, that's going to be about the cadence on this episode.
Nice. I didn't hear the 5-1, but, you know, we'll get there.
And that's it.
There we go. Okay, now we're officially over.
That is the actual cadence to this episode of Neighbor Notes. Thank you guys for listening. If you've got any suggestions or anything, feel free to hit us at our email. That'll be typed in the description because I don't remember exactly what it is right now. Thanks so much to everybody who comes back and checks this out. We are really sorry we had to take the break from this. It was life that we couldn't exactly avoid.
But we assure you, it's going to be back. It's going to be better than ever.
We're back in the saddle again.
Like we started.
Really, really and truly this time. And you know what they always say, the spirit of Trumpet Christmas is in your heart.
That's
And as long as you carry it with you everywhere.
Bach will forever smile down Bach on your life. Bach
will know.
So if you like our podcast, please go ahead and share it around, you know, tell some friends who might be interested in, like, listening to some serious and slightly goofy excerpts.
Learn a little bit about music in a fun way. And we are working really hard on getting an RSS feed up once we get back into regular posting. We're going to get that. And we should have this available on some other platforms. So stick around. Stay tuned for that. And until next time, my name's Sam.
I'm Jake.
And support your local music programs.